Good morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church. My name is Amy. I'm the leader of the praise team. And we are going to start with our first song, God is on the Move. If you could please stand with us and sing.
Anytime a heart turns from darkness to light, anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight, anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served, I know God is on the move. Anytime the choice is made to stand upon the word, I know that God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah, God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, hallelujah. God is on the move today. Generation standing on the truth in each and every nation. God's on the move. Anytime the gospel stirs a searching soul, and someone says, "Send me here," I go.
Good morning again. Welcome to First United Methodist Church. My name is Jeff Klinger, lead pastor. It's a great joy to welcome you as we come together to worship this morning. My hope is that in this next hour that we spend together, you will, in some moment of worship, a song that is sung, a prayer that is prayed, the words of the Psalms and Scriptures, have a connection with God or with others that's meaningful and helpful as you continue to journey. That as a body, we would continue growing closer to who God is calling us to be, and that at the end of the hour, we would go back into the world to serve as we share God's love in community. Let's continue lifting our voices in song and praising God as we worship now.
Shout your praise. love about you. Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on.
Simple refrain, that idea that in Jesus we see one who is way and truth and life, it has become one of those debated theological things, right, that's kind of laughable. It's a response that he offers in the scriptures to Simon Peter when he begins to become anxious about this idea that Jesus would be leaving and wouldn't be with them anymore, and how would they know what to do, and how would they continue the ministry. And Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. And there is this understanding that when we seek to follow Jesus, we seek to live in the ways and in his truths, and that there's this life that comes with that. And so as we gather together for a time of praying this morning, my hope is that wherever you are on your journey, this day is an important next step into coming into the fullness of the life that you were created to live. And so I invite you, as we prepare to sing this next song now, to center your hearts and your minds, to still your body and soul, to breathe deeply of God's presence in this place. And once we sing this song, I'll leave some space in the room where we can lift up those joys and concerns silently that we carry with us today. I'll lead us following that in a pastoral prayer. And then as we close this time of praying together, I'll invite us all to lift our voices and to pray together the Lord's Prayer. If you're not familiar with those words, they'll be projected on the screen behind us there. One of those great prayers of our faith, again, that centers us on Jesus, who teaches us the way, the truth, and the life. Let's continue singing together now as we prepare to pray together.
Refuge in the night.
God, we pray that our days, our lives, our decisions, our actions would bring glory to your name. That as people see us, they would see an intentional desire to love you and to love neighbors. That as people see us, they would see a people desiring to be a different kind of community. And so we gather today, O God, for this time of worship, to step away from the rush and the busyness and the worry. We gather for this time to pause, to lift our songs in praise, to read and reflect on the scriptures, to share our stories with the great hope that we would continue becoming a community where your will is done, a community that helps your will to be done all throughout our community. And so today, God, as we turn our attention to the book of Psalms, to the ways in which the great songs of our faith help us to be people of thanksgiving and painful honesty in lament and praise, that all that we do, that all that we are, would be to your honor and your glory. And so today, God, we pause again. We lift our voices together in community and we join them praying the prayer that Jesus invites his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Again this morning, we are joined by a member of our community to share a piece of their story with us. And so before Jana reads scripture, I want to invite Will Nager to come forward. Many of you know Will. He is a Topeka High graduate who was baptized in this church and confirmed in this church and is active as a member of the choir and in things here now. And so Will, continuing with this sharing of stories, has asked to share a piece of his story with us this morning. Thank you, Will, for being here.
Thank you, Jeff. Good morning. My name is Will Nager. Earlier this year, my dad sent a message to my mother, my sisters, and myself. The information that my dad was sharing was about the upcoming general conference of the United Methodist Church. For those of you that don't know, at the beginning of next year, this church will have a general conference discussing how the global United Methodists will think about the issue of human sexuality. At the center of that is how we will minister to people who consider themselves to be part of the LGBTQ community. This is a question that I believe that we should not just rush into this upcoming year, but leading up to that, have conversations across all Methodist churches about what we want to see from that. When I saw my dad's message telling me that the church that I grew up is going to be taking on this topic, I felt both an opportunity and a responsibility to add my own voice to the conversation. A few years ago, after a lot of internal debate and struggle, I concluded that I myself am bisexual. Whenever I came out to my family and a few close friends, I was lucky enough to be supported and encouraged and loved. Many people are not that lucky. During the conversations with my immediate family, there were two questions that I remember. My sister asked me if this news was timed because I would be introducing them to anyone in particular. I told her that was not going to be happening. And my mom asked me what that meant for my faith. I told my mom that I personally see no conflict between my sexuality and my Methodism. When I think of the stories that I learned here at this church and the scripture I've studied, I think about how Jesus served those who had not been served before, and he went out of his way to radically love people. He did this despite causing discomfort in many who had long been leaders in the church and government and all over structures of power in his society. His radical love was a great gift. I think we are also called to show radical love even whenever it comes with discomfort. Recently, I was listening to an interview with Jose Antonio Vargas. He is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and also happens to be living in the United States undocumented. He talked about a process that I think many people in marginalized communities can relate to of lying, hiding, and passing. Lying about who they are, hiding about what repercussions people might impose on them for who they are, and then passing or appearing to be part of a segment of society that would be more convenient or less burdensome. For years, I lied to both myself and to others about my sexuality. I told myself that what I was feeling was just misplaced or illegitimate or just completely fabricated. I used lies to convince myself and to convince others that I was straight when I was not. I can remember that as I advanced in my own process of self-acceptance, there was a period of time that when asked about my sexuality, I would just answer that I liked women, which, although true, is not the entire story. There was even once whenever someone asked, "What is your orientation?" and I responded by saying, "North." I did genuinely think that that was what she was asking. It was an odd question to me, but that's what I thought she was asking. But whenever I told people that I like women, I was using that answer as a way to both hide from confronting the issue more head on myself, and as a way to buy myself time to work through what I was feeling. Even now, as I am more open about my sexuality than ever, I still have the privilege of often being able to pass as straight, as being able to appear straight. This means that a lot of times I don't have the burdens automatically on my shoulders. In my past, I have been quite careful about who I talk to about this part of me. When I studied abroad, I listened to little comments that my host families might say, trying to gauge what their reaction might be. I have spent time looking in the mirror, practicing how I might stand or walk or talk as to try and blend in or fit a certain prescribed image that I thought I was supposed to be living up to. I have read and will continue to read and research on local, state, and federal policies as to inform myself of what risks I might be at, whether it be being fired or being evicted. Whenever I talk about the subject with coworkers, I often talk circles around it rather than addressing it directly, and then I've had some odd, evasive small talk with supervisors to avoid even the suspicion. Even though I studied political science and international studies, I'm well aware that if I ever get a job that requires me to study or to go abroad, that there are certain countries I should not go to, because it's entirely possible that if I do, I will be thrown into jail or put to death. I know that for many people, this is not a simple issue or an issue that crosses their lives often. There are people who disagree with me, and there are, I imagine, people who are uncomfortable with the fact that I'm even speaking on this matter this morning. I don't anticipate that there's going to be just absolutely no disagreement or no concerns, and I don't think that necessarily that's the way that it's supposed to be. But I hope that we can all engage as our church discusses this issue over the next year, that we can engage with respect and curiosity about each other's feelings on the matter. I know that this building and also that Jeff have been so integral in my faith journey, but I believe it was a few weeks ago whenever Jeff said that the church is something that exists whenever the building has burnt down and the pastor has left. This church has been so much love, so much support, and so much security for me over my entire life. I know I am extremely grateful to have that. I also know that many people don't have that. They don't have that community that they grew up in that supported them, and they don't feel that they can engage with a community like ours. My intention of speaking to people is not to convince people to change their mind or suggest that I know exactly what the World United Methodist Church should be doing. I feel that I'm in a position that I can help our congregation remember that although this might be something that crosses your mind from time to time, for many people, this is not something that is abstract. For many people, this is a very real issue that affects their lives every single day. And if anyone would like to engage in more conversation in the coming weeks or months or however long, I would be happy and I am eager to engage in those conversations, not to convince anyone, not to debate, but to ask more questions and to better understand where people are coming from and how people feel about this matter. I believe that the United Methodist Church has an opportunity as we discuss what might be the best course of action in this. We can draw not only from our scriptures of love or our traditions of grace, but also from our experiences and our reason and how they inform us. We can show radical love to others, and we can make sure that this church is a welcoming place for not just those who already come to church on Sundays or are involved in any number of activities that this church is a part of, but also those that don't see themselves welcome at a place like this. I am optimistic about how we as a church here in Topeka, Kansas, and we as a Great Plains Conference, and we as a World United Methodist Church can move forward on a number of issues, including this one. And I hope that we can radically love God, that we can radically love each other, and in the way that we do this, that whenever other people see us, that they might just want to know our God. Thank you.
Okay, I am Jaina Greenwood, and I'm going to be doing the scriptures, reading the scriptures today. So get your Bibles out if you brought them, or your devices if you would prefer to use those. We're going to read from Psalms and start at chapter 107, verses 8 and 9. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind. For he satisfies the thirsty, and the hungry he fills with good things. And then reading from Psalm chapter 44, verses 23 and 24. Rouse yourself. Why do you sleep, O Lord? Awake, do not cast us off forever. Why do you hide your face? Why do you forget our affliction and oppression? And then from Psalms chapter 145, verses 1 through 3. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable.
Thank you, Jaina. I appreciate you reading those words. If you were looking for your pew Bible this morning, I would remind you that last week we talked about, as we began this series, we were going to pull the pew Bibles out of the pews and not project scriptures on the screens, with the hope that that might help you lean in a little bit more to bringing your Bible into worship and opening that actively during our time together. So for the next several weeks yet, I would invite you to bring your Bibles with you. I know some of you carry a device on which you like to access the scriptures, and that's always great too. But if there's a Bible that you regularly read for devotions and study, please do be bringing that with you into worship. Also, would draw your attention to the bulletin that you got as you came in through the doors this morning. If you haven't already, please do fill out the connection card. It's that perforated tear-off on the back cover. Each week in worship, whether you are a first-time guest with us, a long-time member, or somewhere in between, we ask you to fill this out. And as you come forward later in the morning, we ask you to make this an offering of yourself and to place it in the basket before you there as a way of offering yourself to God as a tangible act in worship. You can also, on the back of that connection card, share prayer requests if you have those that you'd like to lift up, and sign up for various things in our community of faith as well. But again, first-time guests, long-time members, everywhere in between, we love it if you make that offering of yourself. Now this morning at 8:15 and 11 o'clock, we have changed things up, and it's impacting you too, I am afraid. What we have done is gotten very creative in the presentation of the sermon on a special Sunday with lots of choral music. And so as we look at the Psalms, we broke the sermon up into these little pieces, and I feel the great need for my crutch as I try to weave them back together for you here at 9:30. And so I'm going to hang closer over here than I normally do. I hope that you'll forgive me for that. But there are some places today as we look at and weave through the Psalms that I want to make sure to really lift up the words that I wrote in an intentional way. As we begin, though, again, we are spending these weeks looking at the Bible. It is a book, but it's not just a book. It is a collection. It is a library. There are 66 books contained within these pages. We call the first 39 of them the Old Testament, written primarily in Hebrew. They take place before the life and death and resurrection of Jesus. The remaining 27 we call the New Testament, written in Greek after the life and death and resurrection of Jesus. These 66 books are written by countless authors. They are written over thousands of years, and the stories and instruction and wisdom and poetry contained in these pages have inspired people through the centuries to live differently and to be engaged in their communities so that their communities might further come to reflect God's kingdom here on earth. Again, I realize that to address the contents of this great book in 5 weeks, we'll be able to only barely scratch the surface. But my hope would be that we'll find, woven through these weeks, the significant themes about God's creative generosity. The God, as we talked about last week, that creates everything that is and then invites us as human beings to be caregivers and to be stewards. That we would come to further understand that everything that we have and everything that we are comes first as a gift from God. And I believe that the more that we can come to live into and understand that reality, the more we can reflect the generous goodness of God for the world around us. And so these stories in these pages, these 66 books, it is my hope that the more we come to understand the stories of God's love for us contained in these pages, the more that we can exist and live for the good of the city. Now, last week, I joked about how we would begin by a quick overview of the first 18 books in the Bible, Genesis through Job. And we really didn't look at all of them in great detail. We just grabbed three different snapshots to paint the picture of God's work in creation. But today, we turn our attention to just one of the books of the Bible. It's the 19th, if you're keeping track, the book of Psalms, located right in the middle of your Bible. If you were to just open it up kind of in the halfway place, you would likely fall into the book of Psalms somewhere. The Psalms are a collection of songs. The 150 that are in our Hebrew scriptures were the songbook of ancient Israel. Now, as we think about that phrase, the songbook, understand it was never put together like the hymnal in the pews in front of you, right? It was never like, here's the synagogue songbook. But these 150 songs were sung, shaping the communal life of the people of God as they sought to live in relationship with one another and with God. If you look at the 150 Psalms, you'll find in there great, rich poetry. Even on the pages, as you look, it's laid out as poetry. And we don't always know the tunes to which they were sung or chanted, but the poetry continues to tell those rich stories of God's love. As we look at the Bible today, even if you open up to the very beginning of the book of Psalms, many Bibles will say book one. And within the Psalms themselves, they are broken down and divided into five different books. I think it's confusing that we call those books. It's probably more appropriate to call them sections because the book of Psalms is a book into itself. But those five sections are one way that the text can be divided up. My preferred division of the text, though, is more thematic. And there are lots of different ways to do this. Different people at different times have broken the Psalms down into different groups, but I find it most helpful to focus on three. And those are the three. Jaina read an example of each of those three types of Psalms. We'll look at those briefly this morning with the hope that we can understand how they are shaping us and forming us. Those three types of Psalms are Psalms of thanksgiving, Psalms of lament, and Psalms of praise. And the hope is that as we come to understand the collective beauty of this songbook, that the songs of ancient Israel captured in the Psalms will help us better understand and experience the work of God in our lives and in the world today. Now, Psalms of Thanksgiving is where we begin. Hymns and psalms and these songs that were a part of communal worship were almost exclusively communal songs, not individual songs. There would be a song leader that was leading worship in the temple, but it was rare for it to be a solo. You know, it was not that a person would come and stand before the gathered body and sing, and the gathered body would just kind of sit back and think, ooh, they're a little flat today, or ooh, I really like this song. I mean, it wasn't about kind of having that performance mindset that often exists. It was about that leader leading the collective people of God together in singing community songs about what God had done in the lives of the community. And so when those psalms of thanksgiving were sung, they were not always just about one person saying, I am thankful for this thing that God has done for me. They were community songs sung with thanksgiving for what God had done in the midst of that community. The first of those psalms that Jana read from this morning is a psalm of thanksgiving, Psalm 107. I want to point you just to those 8th and 9th verses that she read. Again, if you'd open your Bible to Psalm 107, you'll find it there. And this is an example. If you look at the top of that psalm, at least in this study Bible, it says Book 5, Psalm 107 to 150. So this is the first of that fifth division of the psalms. Verses 8 and 9, I invite you to hear these words of thanksgiving that come from the community. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind. For he satisfies the thirsty, and the hungry he fills with good things. It is a song of thanksgiving for the way in which God has provided for that community in that time. A psalm of thanksgiving for God's provision. It is an acknowledgement that anything that persons have to drink comes as a gift from God. And anything that persons have to eat comes as a gift from God. And so as we sing the Psalms of Thanksgiving, as we today pray and study the Psalms of Thanksgiving, the hope is that it helps us assume that posture of gratitude and understand that everything that we have and everything that we are comes to us through the work of God in our lives, that we can be thankful for that. So often, it seems, we fall into the trap of thinking that if we have something, if we have something to eat, if we have something to drink, it's because we earned it, and because we're worthy, and because we're good enough. Our entire system of living in community is structured around that idea that you have to earn what you get. but the grace and the economy of God that gives freely, gives to those who are thirsty and gives to those who are hungry something to eat and something to drink. And we are invited as stewards and caregivers of God's creation to receive those gifts, but not to hoard them and hold them for ourselves, but to share them in community so that everybody has access to those things that are needed. When we sing the Psalms of Thanksgiving, they can help us better understand and experience what God has done for us and is doing in our lives and in the world. The second of the types of psalms are psalms of lament. And there are often in the divisions that people make about different types of psalms, they talk about individual lament and communal lament, but for the sake of our brief time this morning, we will weave those together and talk about lament generally. This is a psalm that cries out in anguish. The lament is a psalm that indicates that something is not right and that God's presence is needed in the midst of that time. Throughout the Psalms, you'll read expressions of people crying out in pain and crying out in anguish and crying out in the injustices that people are facing. And as those cries come, they indicate a dependence upon God. And it allows us to remember that even in the midst of those most difficult and painful times, God is with us. One of my favorite of the Psalms of Lament is the 23rd. It's believed that King David wrote the 23rd Psalm after learning that his son had been killed by his troops in battle. And so when he speaks about the God who walks with us through the valley of the shadow of death, it is a crying out that even in the midst of those difficult times, we look to God for support and for strength. And then finally, transitioning to psalms of praise. If psalms of thanksgiving are giving thanks to God for specific things that God has done, and psalms of lament are crying out to God in anguish and pain, desiring to be connected to God as a source of strength, psalms of praise are songs that give praise to God simply for the nature of who God is. That God is good, that God is powerful, that God creates, that God gives gifts, that God is with us. It's not necessarily a specific thing that happened for which we give thanks, but rather it's the nature of God. These kinds of songs arise from our very core in the bigness and the vastness of life experiences. Think about the feeling that swells within you when you get caught up in the beauty of a big Kansas sky. You know, whether it's the stars at night or the sunset or the sunrise, that awe that can overcome you. Think about that feeling when you hold an infant in your arms for the very first time, maybe your child or your grandchild, the bigness and the vastness and the goodness of God. That's the language of psalms of praise. And for the sake of our consideration today, I want to point you again to Psalm 145, to the first three verses that are there. Again, the heading above Psalm 145 in this text says, "The greatness and the goodness of God," right? It's not about a specific thing that God has done. It is simply about the nature of God. "I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable." When we sing together psalms of praise, we are reminded of the goodness and the greatness of God. We can come to better understand and know the goodness and the greatness of God at work in the world. And so as we reflect on God's work in our lives, the Psalms can remind us of the specific things that God has done. They can remind us to trust God in the midst of the difficult and painful times, and they can remind us simply of the good and loving nature of God. The songs of ancient Israel captured in the Psalms help us to better understand and experience God's work in our lives and in the world today. Again, the Psalms contain so much beautiful poetry. Even though the words were written centuries ago and written in a different language, when we read the Psalms today, there is this rich imagery that speaks to us and that can be an important part of shaping us and forming us as we seek to grow in the faith. And so my invitation to you would be find a way and a rhythm to read the Psalms. Maybe you're already a part of a Bible plan and you're reading the scriptures with some intentionality. That's great. And probably the Psalms are woven through that. But if you're not already, I'd invite you. There are 150 of them. Some of them are very short, some a little bit longer. But you can easily read one psalm each day. And if you would do that, my caution would be don't make it just one more thing on your to-do list to check off. You know, reading the Psalms is not about accomplishing something. Reading the Psalms is not about acquiring the information that you hope will be downloaded to you from that text. Take your time. Read them slowly. Pray before you do that God would open you to the experience of the words of that page. If it's a shorter one, read it several times. Read it out loud. Read it silently. But move intentionally and slowly through the Psalms so that you can be aware of the poetry that exists, so that you can be open to what the Spirit of God is seeking to say to you in the midst of them. My sense is that oftentimes the Bible feels big and daunting and unapproachable, and we don't even know where to begin. And if that's been the case for you, I would invite you to begin with Psalm 1 and to walk through those psalms. And as you read the Psalms of Thanksgiving, my hope would be that you would increasingly come to trust and to see that God is doing good things in your lives and in the world around you, and that you would find ways to give thanks and give voice to the good things that God is doing. And that as you come to read the Psalms of Lament, you would increasingly know and trust that it is okay to cry out in the midst of pain and anguish when you face difficult times, that in fact God is present with you in the midst of those difficult and challenging times. And as you read and pray and study the Psalms of praise, my hope would be that you would increasingly come to understand the very nature of God, the goodness of God, who is present in the midst of all things. In those 150 Psalms, the songbook of ancient Israel, we can come to better understand the work of God in our lives and in the world. And it is my prayer that we would increasingly be a people who are shaped and who are formed by those attitudes of gratitude and thanksgiving for what God has done, who are connected to God even and especially in the midst of painful and difficult times, and who give songs of praise celebrating the very nature of God. The more that we see and understand the reality that God is in all things, that God has created all things, that God has given us all things, and that God invites us to be caregivers and stewards of all things, the more we can reflect that reality for the world around us. Again, may it be so, and may it begin with us. Will you pray with me? God, we are grateful for the pages of the Bible that have been woven together by your faithful servants over generations and brought to us today in so many convenient and simple forms. We confess that often we take it for granted, feeling as if they are different and disconnected words from a different time that have no application to us. But we pray that especially as we think about the Psalms, we would be aware of your call on our lives, that we would be increasingly aware of the reality that you have created it all, that everything that we are and have comes from you, and that we are invited to share those things living generously with the world. All of this we pray, God, in your holy and precious name. Amen. Jesus was a rabbi 2,000 years ago, he would have had the Hebrew scriptures memorized. He would not have had books to carry. He would have had to have gone to the temple or to the synagogue to read from the scrolls. But as he spoke and as he taught and as he ministered, the Psalms come up time and time again. We celebrate today that last supper that Jesus had with his disciples, when he made that final sacrifice for us, that we could again be in relationship with God. We remember him taking the bread and blessing it and breaking it and sharing it with his disciples and inviting them as they ate that to do so in remembrance of him. We remember him taking the cup, giving thanks to God, and then pouring it out and inviting the disciples, whenever they drank from this cup, to do so in remembrance of him. And so today we have the opportunity to remember Christ's sacrifice for us, to remember the invitation that comes as we remember that we are loved and accepted and shaped and formed and called to be Christ's body in the world around us. In just a moment, I will invite you to come forward. We'll have two stations at the very center here. As you come forward, you're invited to place your connection cards, your tithes, your offerings into the basket before you there. And then to step to the servers with your hands cupped and open in front of you as a sign of your readiness to receive. They'll place a piece of bread into your hand. You're invited then to dip that into the cup and to taste the goodness and the sweetness of God's love for you. Once you've received those elements, you're welcome to spend time kneeling if you'd like, and then to return back to your seats by the side aisle. As we celebrate Holy Communion today, I would be clear, this is an open table. It is not First United Methodist Church's table. It is not a United Methodist table. This is Christ's table, and we believe that all are invited to gather around this table for this meal that Christ has prepared for us. I'd invite those who are helping serve this morning to come forward, and all of you to join me in praying together. God, we give you thanks for your Spirit that is with us always and everywhere. We give you thanks for these gifts of bread and cup that are before us now. And we pray that through the work of your Spirit on us and on these gifts gathered here, they would be for us the body and blood of Christ, that as we receive them today, we would be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by your great love. And God, we continue to pray that as we celebrate this meal together, you would make us one. That you would make us one with you, and that you would make us one with each other, and that you would make us one in ministry to all the world until the time comes when all people feast together at your heavenly banquet. All honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Again, all are welcome at Christ's table. Come taste and see that God is good.
Words of life, words of hope, give us strength.
God, we give you thanks for all of the gifts that you give to us. And we return to you now a portion of those gifts that we have brought forward, the offerings of ourselves. And we are hopeful that as we celebrate now this holy mystery, this meal in which you give yourself to us, that we might continue to be shaped and formed in your likeness, to live as your representatives in the world. We are grateful. We are hopeful. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes. I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes. I'll lift my eyes to you. There's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
As you go from this place today, I hope that you do go with the strength of the Lord, that you are increasingly entrusting your life to Him, aware of the fact that everything that we are and everything that we have comes as a gift from God, and that through the Scriptures and through the Psalms especially, we can find words to give voice to the experiences of living, giving thanks to God for the gifts that we give, crying out in the midst of painful things, praising God generally for God's goodness and love. May you continue to grow in the goodness and the love of God and share that with the world around you. as we go from this place today, live your lives in such a way that all who see you might just want to know your God. Amen.